SF Barcast. I am Jeff Cleary.
I am Andrew Lauder.
Andrew Lauder, we are back.
I know, back at full strength.
Back at full strength, reunited again, and it feels so good.
Our fighting, our post-Christmas fighting weight.
Oh, Jesus.
So just more like a Buster Douglas's regular weight, I guess.
Can I tell you, like, when I was home in Massachusetts, I did nothing but eat and drink.
Spoiler alert, you went to Massachusetts.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody knows that.
Everybody knows
All the regular fans of the show know that. And big ups to Paul Abrego.
For hanging in there with me.
Filling in. And even coming up with his own catchphrase, rock and roll.
I think that one's going to stick.
You know, people like rock and roll, right?
Well, I don't know, but it's here to stay. Andrew, where are we today?
Good question. We are at Harry's Bar on Fillmore and what is that? Something.
You know, oh yeah, and
it's in Pacific Heights. We walked up here from Japantown.
It's in Pacific Heights, and yeah. I have kind of high hopes because we have a good seat right by the window,
right?
So we can like sort of, you know, people watch and gawk at people walking by. And Andrew, this fucking neighborhood, it's so ridiculous.
This place, Pine, I believe.
I mean, I'm saying this. Being somebody who lives in the Mission, where there's a lot of like crazy shit that happens.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm tipping my hand here, but when I'm in a place where it's just like super rich people walking around with like not a care in the world, I'm just like, what the? It just seems like I'm in a movie.
But the weird thing is that the Mission is like that now. But like this, it's weird because the Mission is sort of like what Pacific Heights used to be like. Like where, you know, it's like the Mission was a shithole, and then you'd have like the rich people lived in Pacific Heights. Well, now like the Mission is like where the rich people live, and this is just where the like super uber rich
super
heroes
rich.
Live or something. Like it's some kind of like next level money or something.
I know, like I'm looking at some of these shops here, and there's nobody in any of these shops, and the rent on these
like, none of these shops sell anything useful.
Right, yeah, and it's all like super expensive stuff. They must have to like, okay, all we need to do is sell like three things a month, and we can be profitable.
Right.
It's that type of like affluence,
right? Where it's like a custom poodle sweater shop or something. It's like, well, they cost $20,000 a piece, so we only need to sell one a year.
And it's just all these sort of, you know, like fit, like 40-something like socialite women.
Yeah, well, we're definitely. I think we're here at the height of the getting out of your afternoon yoga class. Like,
yep.
If you don't have any sort of job at all, and like, you know, you. You want to look all good and toned up for when your husband gets home with the money.
Yeah.
But, I don't want to, who knows? Maybe they're all very smart, independent women that have made enough money to where they can,
I don't know where you're going with that.
Cocksucking gold diggers. That's all they are.
By the way, Cocksucking Gold Diggers, that's a great band out of Brooklyn.
It really is. Got Bad Brains cover band.
But the thing about this neighborhood is you're talking about kind of comparing it to the Mission.
Yeah.
But yes, there's a lot of like rich young people who live in the Mission, which is in itself annoying. But
sure.
Then you pepper it up with like some destitution. You know, there's like plenty of like street thugs and homeless people and crazy people. Up here, it's just everything's just clean.
Yeah, it's just like this idyllic, like, you know, Celebration Florida, like Disney Wonderland.
Right, to me, it feels like sort of like a section of Epcot Center.
Right.
It's like, can you believe this exists in the world?
We're in Vietnamese Sandwich Land or whatever. You know, it's like we're in high-end Curryville.
And so let's talk about Harry's. I'm going to tip my hand again here. Like, every time I come to a bar, this is a sports bar.
Yeah, it bills itself as one, I guess.
But... every time I come to a bar that is this clean, I'm like, something's got to be wrong.
what did the health department just close them down?
No. I mean, like, it's nice in here. Everything's clean. Yeah. And it's like, this is not like, when I think of a sports bar, I think of like some overweight loudmouth, like screaming about the fucking screaming Roll Tide. This is like a fancy sports bar.
Well, and for everybody that's waiting for... Our year-end spectacular. We'll be doing that soon, so we'll probably have like some sports bars that we mentioned in there. But
we got a little couple things we have to do. A little thing called Sketchfest.
Yeah, exactly. We're kind of busy. It's like cut to me tomorrow, like passed out at 11 o'clock.
Don't worry,
like,
last year will always be there. Did you have a? What was your take on last year? Did you have a good year?
I have a hot take on last year.
I don't have. I have a cold take on last year. I'm like, meh.
You know what, like, I would say overall, not one of the better years, for sure. But you know what? It felt better than 2014, somehow.
I feel like...
I think 2014 was like just like next level shitty. You had the sort of like beginning of the Ferguson thing.
Yeah, that was really bad.
Robin Williams died. Like, you know, everything just like felt like this nonstop like fucking circus ride.
Yeah.
But like, I feel like, I mean, even though I recently left my job,
that's called a tease in the business.
Yeah, exactly. but you know, it wasn't in a way that I feel really terrible about, or like that you know, that I feel bad about my prospects or anything like that. So I feel oddly optimistic for the coming year.
Yeah.
But granted, the last year was kind of a shit show.
It was kind of meh for me. Yeah, it's like, yeah. I don't feel like nothing tremendously good happened.
Right.
I'm at that point after like 2014 and like years like 2001. I feel like if there's something like monumentally shitty didn't happen, it's probably a good year.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
I'm kind of like giving up on the whole thing that something good's going to happen.
Yeah, like or just anything good at all. Like you're just like, nothing aggressively interrupted my life with tragedy. Like,
right.
So I guess that was a good day.
Exactly. That's the best you can hope for, people.
I didn't witness or get hit by a car, so like, onwards and upwards.
Let me ask you this. Did you die? No? Good year.
Yeah, exactly. Best year yet.
So what do you think of this bar so far?
I mean, like you said, it's suspiciously clean.
That's Cameron Esposito.
Oh yeah, you're right. Oh, and her girlfriend Rhea Butcher, who will also be at Sketchfest this year. They they are a very attractive lesbian couple. I will say
yes.
That.
Like,
and yeah, there will probably be a lot of this in the coming episodes where we'll be like either at a bar or like jock sniffing comedians somewhere, which we want to do. And like, I'm sure there'll be tons of times where we'll be like, so anyway, I was removing this boil from my neck, and hey, it's Paula Tompkins.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I feel like we're going to be doing that during this episode because we're at this. I love being perched right by the window.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I said, it's like for people watching, but it's also kind of distracting. You know, something like I could be in the middle of a story and just be like, "Ooh, look at the head on that one."
Exactly.
Sure are a lot of ugly people out.
But so, I mean, like one of the things that brings us to this beautiful Pacific Heights neighborhood is that we had to go pick up our artist badges for Sketchfest. Which is,
they fucked up.
Yeah, exactly. Like, yeah, it's like it's a living monument to their bad choices. But yeah, like sure enough, even though. They weren't able to find the pre-printing badges. We were able to convince them that that we belonged. And
after I threw a mild shit fit and said I've never been so insulted in my life, they quickly remedied that situation.
After I slid her a $100 bill and I said, check under podcasting legend, Andrew Lauder.
The thing is, like, we went and picked up our badges, but like. You could have said you were anyway, but yeah, I'm Kasim Bentley.
Yeah.
Giving my badge.
Well, there were a couple times where, yeah, she gave me, like, or she, like, flashed other people's badges and was like, is this you? Like, you know, no, I'm not Maria Bamford.
Sure, why not? Just give it to me.
Yes, I'm Kyle Kinane. Thank you. My name is Nato Green. Thank you. I'll be doing political comedy.
So the Sketchfest is starting. Is it starting tonight?
I believe it is.
Why am I not on the fucking mailing list? I'm talent.
Well, I mean, you can go to their website, sfsketchfest.com, and find all the information you need.
I don't do that. That's for audience members.
This artist badge should come with a special website that only I have access to.
It's like kind of being like a Jimmy Dore super fan.
That's the premium content. We should have told them, we signed up for the premium content badges. Like, what's that? Oh, did I give $100 to the wrong person?
I just give out $100 to people.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I just paid some guy at the hotel front desk and told him I was lying.
I can't remember the last time we were in the Fillmore or Pacific Heights.
Yeah, it's been a while. I think I want to say like a year ago, like maybe a year ago Christmas, I like sort of like wandered around here trying to do some like last minute Christmas shopping. And
why would you come here, Andrew?
I don't know. I thought I might find something unique and interesting or something, but like, there's nothing unique or interesting here. It's all like, you know, expensive shops full of like garbage.
It's well, I mean, I think the last podcast we did, even remotely close to here, was like the San Francisco Athletic Club.
Oh yeah,
which is on Divisadero.
Yeah, yeah. Or even I guess if you go over the hill in the other direction, like, but we haven't really done that many marina bars. There's like Mauna Loa and like.
Yeah, it's true.
Like that.
So we're branching out. It's not just the Mission anymore.
Exactly. Like yeah, like for, you know, for all you Pacific Heights residents who have been clamoring for an episode. Here it is, and we'll be back in 3 years.
here we are to shit on your neighborhood.
Well, we went to what's it called, the social studies room or something like that, like on which is on like Geary and Fillmore, and it was probably just a little too small and like a little too early in the day. Like yeah, we would have been like sort of doing an episode like in a busy Starbucks or something.
And like many things up in this neighborhood, it was a little too precious.
Yeah, yeah, it was, and like there were. There were like a whole bunch of like law books and everything all over the wall, and like and like it was clearly meant to look like someone's like a disheveled library or whatever, but like I wasn't really buying into it.
I was looking that place up online, and it was saying that like it was voted like best like date bar, and I'm like, when I walked in there and I was like, you know what, of course it is, because it's like, oh, do you like, look at all these leather bound books that I exactly. drink coffee around.
In case you were wondering if I am book smart, I am.
I like smooth jazz and exactly. Reading books. Would you like to come back to my place?
Perhaps we can go for a date at the Boom Boom Room across the street and then have some prescribed sexual intercourse.
Please sign here.
That's right. And after that, I will pay you money to walk around and shop in this neighborhood for a while.
Yeah, this neighborhood... I don't have too many memories of it. Oh, no, I had a couple friends who lived around the corner from here, and that was the height of my Pacific Heights haunting.
Well,
but after that,
I mean, I don't know if he'll want us mentioning this or if it's a secret. But
go
like,
for it.
We ran into a mutual friend of ours named Ruben.
Oh yeah.
Like just coming out of a pizza place as we were walking up here, and which surprised the hell out of both of us because he's like a wine expert or something that like works in and lives in Sonoma County.
I think it was more surprising for him to see us because he's like, "Whoa, you guys are still alive!"
He's like, "Oh my god!" Like, I don't have any money if that's what you guys want. Like, now he was telling us about how he got like a crash pad here because he has to travel like a ton for his work, I guess. But like,
and I was like thinking like, "Oh my god, it has to be super expensive." He said it was like, "Yeah, $12.50."
That's not. I mean, for this neighborhood, that's a steal.
A steal,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But like. I'm sure for some people listening in other parts of the country, they're like, well, that's
insane.
so he's being raped. It's like, well, yes, but we all are.
Yeah, like.
But shout out to Ruben anyway.
Shout out to Ruben.
I'm sure he's a big listener as he
you know,
as he sells high-end piscos and wines.
You know what this neighborhood has a lot of, aside from rich people?
Well. It's like I'm walking around with a snowboard right now. He's walking around with a snowboard.
It has a lot of.
They all are in ski clothes. Like this is so annoying to watch. I like this is the times when I wish it was a video podcast and we could like say like look at these assholes still carrying their snowboards and dressing like they're in Tahoe like when they're coming back on a Thursday.
Well, part of that group is what I was going to say. What I've noticed a lot around here is a lot of dogs.
Yeah, there's a ton of dogs.
And rich dogs, too. Like, dogs who have more money than the both of us.
Right. Well, you can tell that they're, like, rich people dogs because, like, dogs get smaller as they get richer. Like, it's just like, if a dog is, like, can fit on the head of a pin, it's, like, the richest dog in the world.
I remember David Cross used to do a joke about how one of the things that you really upset him was when people left money to their, like, pet. Can you do that?
I'm sure you can't. I mean, like, I'm sure you could, like, set up like a trust that like in order to take care of that animal like you know, in the lap of luxury if you wanted like you'd be like yeah like I'm gonna give you know $1 million to this like pet hospital or whatever you know whatever to or not pet hospital but like hotel or whatever to like treat my like you know, special dog like he's like a millionaire.
If any of our rich listeners are thinking about doing that, I will be the trust for your pet.
And then I will
and I promise
your dog in the ocean and spend all of it.
And I promise the death of your pet will be totally natural.
The death of your pet will be as natural as something starving to death because I am not paying attention to it.
It's like, okay, so like you leave like $2 million to your cat, and so the cat has to eat out of like a crystal goblet.
Right.
It's like the cat doesn't, like, this is the David Cross joke.
Right.
Where he's like, the cat doesn't know, like, crystal.
Like a crystal goblet from a.
From a shit shine shoe.
Like, speaking of, like, David Cross is going on tour again this year, but like he's not at Sketchfest, so screw him.
We're only
dealing with Sketchfest right now.
Exactly. We don't have time for any of those other hacks.
We've got an entire show to write.
Even though we're at a sports bar, mm-hmm. it's some pretty weak sports that are going on right now.
It's a ton of interesting, almost like borderline weird art on the walls too. Like, where it's sort of like I recently saw a bunch of pictures of the like these murals that are at the Denver International Airport that are like,
oh, those are supposed to be like
they're like crazy, like, yeah, fucking super cryptic and, like, you know, weird, yeah. Like, yeah, these
well,
like,
there's all these like conspiracy theories about the Denver airport,
yeah,
about how it's like supposed to be like the meeting place for all the whatever,
right, the bankers that run the world,
yeah, exactly. Yeah, but it's like, yeah, like it's supposed to be like a bunker underneath the Denver airport or something like that, just in case it's like a fucking zombie apocalypse or something, right. Like that. Fuck all that.
Like, so many of those like sort of conspiracy things are like almost impossible to believe, just because like once you realize that most like most bureaucracies, like they're lucky if they can get like just the thing that they're supposed to do, like, you know, like, yeah, they're lucky if they can get that right. Like, the amount of coordination it would take to like actually like fuck with the system from inside, like, is like almost laughably impossible in most cases. Like,
all that conspiracy theory bullshit, though, it's like, it says more about the person who believes it than the actual content of what they're talking about, because like the type of like social capital that it grants these people is like, oh, everyone else is living with their eyes closed. I know.
Oh, yeah,
it's
exactly.
True.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and you're just like, oh, okay.
It's like a built, yeah. It's like a built-in, like, you know, buffer for your, you know, for your bullshit or whatever. Is like, if anybody questions it, you just be like, oh yeah, well, you're fucking part of the problem.
Oh, oh, like, someone, they already got to you.
It's like, ooh, I see the, you know, money is legal tender. People got to you as well.
Or these people who deny the moon landing. It's like, oh, you still believe in the moon landing? It's like, well, you know what?
I still believe in it.
Go to,
after all the proof,
go to a fucking, you know, a Radio Shack, if it still exists. Yeah, can we have another round?
Please.
That'd be great.
Thanks.
Go to a Radio Shack, buy like a medium powered like telescope pointed at the fucking moon, and you can see where they left some shit.
Right.
On the moon.
Yes.
So, keep believing in whatever stupid bullshit you believe in.
Oh, sure. Like, did you buy your telescope from the store? Well, they put the they put the flag in it.
Like, somebody from the government is going to be like, we have to quiet this guy. He's getting too close.
That's right. He's got a telescope. That son of a bitch.
Anyway, did you have a good Christmas?
You know, I had a very uneventful Christmas, which
once again,
like,
that's
using
good.
Exactly. Using our current logic of what's good and what's bad, it was a great Christmas because nothing happened.
Yeah.
Although, I don't know, didn't even, like, can't think of any, like, huge terrible news that broke on Christmas or anything, but, like, I don't know. It was fine. And yours?
It was shitty.
Not great.
I love going home. I love seeing my family, but there's always some tragedy that happens when
you
I come home.
You usually go home for Thanksgiving, though, so this is, like, the first time you've been home for Christmas in a while. Like, did you finally get to see actual snow?
A little
somewhere?
Bit. Oh, just a little bit of it. Like I was, like, saying to Paul in the last episode, he was saying, like, he really loves the holidays. I'm like, really? What's that like? Because I don't...
Well, he has kids, right?
Yeah, yeah, he's got kids.
So, like, you can live it vicariously through them, where we have to just live it vicariously through...
through, like, wild turkey.
A bottle of Jack Daniels.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, I know, like, a lot of people get crazy. Like, for me, it's Halloween. I go big on Halloween, and then after that, it's all downhill.
After that, it's 364 days until I have fun again.
Right, exactly. But, like, it was nice to be home. It was very warm. I got to see a little bit of snow. And I'm happy to be back. I'll say that much, yeah.
That's good. I guess that's sort of what you want out of a trip is to is to not feel terrible about coming back. And, like, if you can feel great about coming back, even better.
Yeah, exactly. Even if you're mildly okay with it, it's like that's like a tsunami of good feelings.
That's right. Even if you're just thankful to be alive and around interesting people again.
That's true. I had
no offense to all of our listeners and previous guests from the southeastern Massachusetts area. I'm sure it's lovely.
Oh, no, fuck them.
It looks good on you.
Okay, so last night I had Jeff Cleary's first trivia night of the 2016 In God's Name Limited at the right spot. So, I'm going to pepper you with a couple of trivia questions from last night.
Pepper away, and, damn it.
Just for the record, you have not seen these questions. I have not talked to you about these questions.
I have not, Mr. Copperfield.
They have been, like, sealed in a vault.
That's right. They're being opened by the accounting team of Ernst & Young.
Remember that when they used to do that on the Oscars? They used to bring out the two guys.
It's yeah, like, I like that.
Like, they kind of, like, why were they, why?
It lasted a really long, like, it lasted much longer than it should have. Because, like, we were, like, deep into the 80s and 90s, and they were still like, okay, like, there was our billion-dollar montage. Now here's, like, the two guys with a suitcase. like, what?
It's like, there's only, like, guys with a suitcase is, like, the guy with a suitcase who can fire the nuclear weapons who follows the president.
Right.
That's an interesting person. The guy who's, like, telling you that Sally Field won. Like, who gives a fuck?
Yeah. Like, if it wasn't for this guy... We would just give awards away willy-nilly to anybody.
Whoa. Well, look at these two guys. Can they keep secrets? All right. According to the Billboard Magazine Hot 100 chart, three of the top five songs this week are sung by the same artist. Who is that artist?
This is the Billboard what charts? Just the
Hot 100. So it's Hot 100. It's a pop chart.
That'd be Justin Bieber.
It is that Canadian Bieber.
Monsieur Bieber.
How is that guy so fucking successful?
Well, that's the thing is, like, I don't even know, like as far as music charts go anymore, I don't know if, like, the people that, like, are on the top of the music chart, are those just the people with the fans that are, like, enough in the past to buy records and, like, you know, buy music still?
I have no idea.
Or is it, like... Like, if you have, like, a fan base that's just, like, you know, all about, like, stealing music, then that's kind of unfair for you, isn't it? Like, it seems like Taylor Swift and, like, Justin Bieber are the only people that sell records, and everybody else is broke. And Adele, yeah.
But, yeah, like, you know, Adele, like, set some, like, record for sales.
Right.
And I'm like, who the fuck buys... Did somebody...
You know, it's got to be, like, people over, like, 40 or 50 that, like, have no idea, like, how to get music.
I saw an interview with, what's his name? Darius Rucker, Hootie.
Mr. Blowfish to you.
And he said that the best thing he ever did career-wise is that he transitioned into country music. And he's had, like, number one country albums. Right. And it's like, yeah, because those fucking rednecks haven't figured out how to use the computer yet.
That's why Adam Duritz is lining up for soup at a homeless shelter right now.
Exactly. It's like, that's why the band of horses is crashing in my place. Somebody, as for a gift, Christmas gift, someone gave me, like, a iTunes, like, card.
I was like, what am I supposed to do with this?
That's cute. I download everything for free.
That's cute. I'll just mail it back to Steve Jobs.
Well, I'm like, I guess I could cut Coke with this.
It's like, you got me a Coke knife.
Thanks a lot. I didn't know you cared. How about this? Last month, who was selected as Time Magazine's Person of the Year 2015?
Wow. It wasn't Adele.
It was not Adele.
I think that a lot of people were afraid, and rightfully so, that it would be Trump, right?
Yes.
Was it Putin?
Nope. It was a foreigner.
Angela Merkel.
Angela
Merkel. Excuse me.
Is it Angela? I think I said Andrea Merkel last night, and people are like, it's Angela. I'm like, I'm sorry, sorry.
They're like, hey, it's pronounced Angela, you stupid motherfucker.
I was like, look, when you're friends with her, you get to call her the Merc.
That's right. call her Big Ange.
Tell her Big Ange sent you.
That'd be fantastic.
And similarly, who is named Sports Illustrated Sports Person of the Year for 2015?
God, it has to be Steph Curry, right?
Nope.
Ah, that's ridiculous. is it Bruce Jenner?
It's
I mean, it does fit the bill of sports person very well.
Sports whatever of the year.
Sports something or other. Sports AZDZ of the year, whatever.
It was Serena Williams.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's, I mean, good for Serena Williams. I can't really argue against it too much, but...
I can't argue against it too much, but, like, I guess she's super dominant, but I don't watch tennis, so... Yeah.
Well, yeah, it's like, I know that she's dominating, but I don't know that the competition is so fierce that, like, that's impressive. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, if I knew, like, if I could name 10 women's tennis players, I'd probably be more impressed.
Here's how, last time I looked at, like, the female tennis rankings, here's how it goes. Serena Williams, and then just a bunch of Russian girls.
Right. Her sister, Venus, somewhere. Yeah. Yeah. And yeah, and like yeah, like 500 Russian girls and a couple of like hot Slovenians.
why do like those Eastern Bloc like countries love their tennis so much?
There is that one. God, I wish I could pull her name. Yeah, let's go. like Ivana something or other, Ivana, but she's like
Svetlana.
I think she's either Slovakian or Slovenian or yeah, but like. But she's probably the most smoking hot tennis player at the moment.
Yeah.
Like Ivanovic, I think. Something like that. Anyway.
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm going to take your word for it, though.
If this was a tennis podcast, this would be all it would be. It would be like, I saw this one girl she's hot. Her name is like Minka Vokic or something.
Hey, let's take a break. How about that?
Yeah,
I think we've been going for a while. I know we haven't been together in a while, so like you want to really like hit it. But like, let's give our listeners a chance to catch their breath from all the laughing they've been doing.
Exactly.
And then when we come back, we'll start the laugh machine all over again. All right. This is SF Barcast, and we're at Harry's Bar in the Fillmore. All right, and we are back at Harry's.
Harry's Bar.
Harry's.
It's a very standard name for a bar, but like yeah, it's a,
or Prince.
Like I suppose. Sure.
Prince Harry. You know what? The thing, like, we were talking about this neighborhood being, like, kind of, like, older and affluent.
Yeah.
I just went to the bathroom, and it's like, you and I are not what the people would call young.
Right.
But we're probably the youngest people in this bar. And
yeah,
it's a sports
it's
bar.
Weird. Yeah, like, I mean, there's a few people sort of hanging out, like, that may be slightly younger than us, but there's three or four, like, fairly elderly couples here, like, which is, yeah, like, not something you expect to see at a sports bar.
And it's like when you see, like, an elderly person in a bar in the Mission, you're like, oh, shit, where fucking went wrong there?
Right. But, like, who's showing their parents around this weekend?
But, like, here, it's like, you can tell, like, all these, like, older people are just, like, they're retired, very successful.
Right.
They're doing fine. Their only problem is that they're really old.
Yeah, like it's a bit of a strange place to retire too, if you think about it. I mean, like,
yeah,
like yeah, I guess yeah, it takes a certain like type of person to be like, yeah, I'm not going anywhere like relaxing or beach. Like, I'm gonna stay in the city and like yeah, and yeah, you know, and be the coolest person forever.
I kind of like that idea though. If yeah. It was a nicer, if it was a neighborhood that I felt a little bit more. You know, connection to.
Yeah.
Like, you know, when you go to North Beach and you see, like, the old people, like, at Gino and Carlo's, and they're like,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, oh, yeah, this is where you grew up, this is where you want to be, right. That sort of stuff. But it's like, I can't see. Can you see me, like, 20 years from now sitting in this bar telling, like, being all drunk, spouting off about how I used to have a podcast myself?
With the Zoom X10 or whatever they make then, like, recording a podcast?
Yeah, it's like,
well, this kind of screwed up thing is that, so I mean, like, I mean, your neighborhood that you've spent the most time in and like, you know, can identify the most with is the Mission.
Sure.
And the Mission has like undergone such a complete and total like upheaval that like, there's not really a sense of like 20-year-old history there or anything. I mean, like, it's just, you know, like there's a couple places that desperately try to like cling on to it, but like they're, you know, in the middle of being overrun or like, you know, kicked out of town pretty much. So like,
I know I've said before that I'm because there's all these like young tech rich tech kids like moving in, I'm destined to be like the guy they point to and be like, see that guy, old man over there? He lived here before the internet.
That's right.
That guy's got stories.
That's right. Lived here in the early 90s, back when like, yeah, like dial-up speeds were 56K.
You think he ever used a rotary phone? Oh, of course.
You're like sitting there like, yeah,
you
I
mean
did.
You mean in a museum?
Why are you guys talking like this? I'm sitting right here.
I'm right here. I can hear both of you guys. hey, you want this is segment two, so you want to do a little sports report?
We can do that. Do you want to like? Do you have any sports trivia from last week to start off with, or do you
want
to
like
nail some of those onto the end of it or something?
No, my first question of the night was: who was the head football coach the Niners just fired?
Oh, is his name Pagano? Like, there's like a coach for the Lions that like I think kept his job. That's Pagano. No,
that's Chuck Pagano.
Okay,
you know it's for he's for the Colts.
The Colts. That's right. That's who I'm thinking of. Because I'm thinking that there's like two or three coaches that are on this like rotating like tour of the NFL coaching jobs, and like they all have like these, you know, names that sound like they should be running pizza places, and like you look at them and they're like, why would anybody hire that guy? It's just like, hey, Mama Luke, but like, it's
like hey, jabroni, get over here.
I can't think of that guy's name. What the hell is his name?
Jim Tom Zula.
Tom Zula.
Tom Zula.
It's like, do you want extra Tom Zula on that?
You know, he's back to slinging pizzas.
Put some extra Tom Zula on that motherfucking shit.
And there was a report, there was a story about how he may actually go down in history as one of the most highly paid coaches of all time.
Really?
Because he only coached for 1 year. And the
what, he signed like a 10-year contract or something?
He had like some like multi-year contract, and but the Niners decided they were going to like pay him out. So he's getting, for 1 year of work, he's getting $14 million.
and a year where they missed the playoffs and five, underachieved by every possible
they won
measure.
Five fucking games. Right. That's five more than you and I won.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I think I could have won four, like, just by myself.
And he's getting $14 million? That's going to buy a lot of Tom Zula, I'll tell you that.
That's right. That guy's going to be swimming in Tom Zula.
But also, like, the Niners, like, man, like, they're such in disarray.
Yeah, because, like, well, I mean, like, this is a team that went to the Super Bowl 3 years ago? Is it three or 4 years ago?
I think it was 3 years ago.
And, like, they could not be, more, like, further away from the Super Bowl now. Like, Kaepernick's like a sort of living joke at this point. Like, he'll probably be dealt
with. He's on his way out.
Yeah.
So they have Blaine Gabbert, who's their Blaine Yo Gabbert Gabbert.
You know, the guy that was so good that Jacksonville cut him.
Yeah. So he's their quarterback now. And so clearly, Kaepernick's on his way out. So they need a quarterback, right?
Yeah. they could also use a running back and receivers.
So there's this really good quarterback coming out, Goff from Cal.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And there's a few like really good quarterbacks. So maybe like elite caliber quarterbacks that are coming out. And on the last game of the season, the Niners went into overtime and won the fucking game, which moved them from the number four position to the number seven position in the next year's draft.
Brilliant.
So even when they win,
move Gabagool or whatever your name is.
So even when they win, they lose. It's like they're not going to get any of those good like quarterbacks now. So the fuck?
Might as well draft another tight end or whatever. Yeah, and if you couple that with just the whole move to Santa Clara and the whole franchise just seems to be like in disarray. Like,
I can't. And they had to like squeeze out Harbaugh because. Whatever, he couldn't get along with
because he had a mouth on him or something. That guy didn't do exactly what we said.
He had too much sass mouth or something like that.
You're being fired for excessive sass mouth.
How about the NFL playoffs? Are you excited that the Seahawks made it in and my Patriots limped into the playoffs?
You know what? But, to be fair, I feel like Like, when was the last meaningful game that, Gronkowski, played in? They haven't thrown to him for, weeks. And, so I think, they've been coasting a little bit. And,
they lost four of their last six.
Yeah. The only, mistake I would think that they made is probably, playing Brady as much as they did in the last couple weeks. They injured him out of the playoffs, last week. And they were, it was, the most meaningless game in history. Unless you really want home field advantage over the Broncos or whatever, it's who cares?
Yeah, exactly. So, and also, the Patriots had already had wrapped up a first round bye.
Yeah.
So they have an extra week to lick their wounds because they have so many injuries on that team.
Right.
Which is really what we needed. But we don't really need the fucking the number one seed. It would have been great to have. Yeah. It would have been monumental for us to have it, considering they're basically a mash unit of football because they have so many fucking injuries.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, don't get, Brady. This is the year of all these, backup quarterbacks stepping in for, hurt, starting quarterbacks. So, and, the Patriots are just lucky that fucking Brady hasn't got hurt. So why are you, playing him?
Yeah, exactly. Why has Jimmy Garoppolo been playing since, week, eight or something?
Get in there, Garoppolo Islands. And your Seahawks made it.
They did, although, I read a recent article. I think it was, in ESPN, the magazine or something, which I accidentally, not accidentally, someone else accidentally had subscribed to it and sent it to my house. And so I've just
sure
been,
they
getting,
did.
No, I like, yeah.
It's called we. It's called Jen. Because, I'm a gentleman.
I read this article about, Russell Wilson and, he has this whole sort of, weird sort of cult of religion around him that where there's all these players that go to the same pastor that he does, and it's and it's so annoying to me, and it's it makes me not want to root for them, it's really conflicting because
weird.
I like him as a player, I think he's great, but personality wise he just seems a creepy religious dude to me.
He did say that God was telling him it was God's plan that he threw that interception, and God was telling him not he's
God's got a lot of weird plans for football.
You think God has a plan, really? Go live in the mission for a while. God does not have a fucking plan.
Right. He should be forced to go to Syria and tell fleeing refugees about what God's plans are.
Right, exactly.
It's oh really, they're to help you? And that sucks.
He's dating this super hot singer.
Yeah, yeah.
And he said God told him not to have sex with her. I'm like, did you clear that with her?
Did you ask for an appeal?
There was a story about not too long ago about how Tim Tebow's girlfriend broke up with him because of lack of sex. And after that happened, people just start. This girl is a. She's a model, and she's I think she's a Miss America pageant contestant.
Yeah.
And people are posting all these bikini photos of her, and they're really, Tebow? What? I think here's the thing. I hate to sound like a Grinch here, but for some reason it does give me great joy when religious people fail.
Yeah. I can see that.
The whole Mark Jackson thing where he's just he's super religious and right. And they had a great record last year, and the team fired him. People were like, What? How can you fire him? He had a great record. And then the next year, they bring in Steve Kerr, and they win the championship. And it's like, yeah, fuck you, Mark Jackson.
And your God.
Fuck you and your God.
turns out Jesus wanted to be fired as bad as anything else.
And, Tim Tebow, doing his little Tebowing on the sidelines when he was at Florida.
Yeah,
he was arguably the greatest, college quarterback of all time. Right. And... He was super religious, and then just am I just being a pig here and thinking that he was the Heisman winner? He was the quarterback for Florida University,
right?
And he didn't
Gators. Go he Gators.
Didn't, he didn't fucking parlay that into any extracurricular horizontal entertainment. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
Is he gonna look back on it when he's old and decrepit? Is he gonna be well, I did the right thing. Or is he going to be like, I should have been slamming all those girls in Florida?
He's going to be going down a whole list going, oh, oh, no, why? Oh, why did I do that? No.
Oh, God has a plan. Apparently, God's plan is blue balls.
Exactly. Like,
so, there you
yeah,
go.
Well, I mean, like, for somebody, like, it's weird. I know, there's so many dogs, like, walking by. Like, I feel the same way in a weird, I mean, like, and this sounds terrible because, like, on every face of it, he seems like a nice, normal person. But, like, Tony Dungy, like, because he's
guy.
So religious and, like, yeah. But he's, like, religious in like, anti-gay way and stuff like that. But he's like, I'm Mr., like, you know, like, helpful football coach. So, like, you know, it doesn't matter that I'm totally intolerant. He really pisses me off, and I, you know, I hope he does not succeed.
I hope the thing is, like, I cannot. I know he won like a Super Bowl,
right?
But the thing is, he's the most boring analyst.
Yeah, totally.
His voice, everything he has to say is middle of the road. He's always like there's nothing dynamic about him. Like whether you like Charles Barkley or not, if you think like he says stupid shit every once in a while, at least it's entertaining.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Tony Dungy always, like, is in the middle of the road. Oh, well, you know, it's like he never says anything that's, like, entertaining.
Right. Do you remember when Charles Barkley got, threw a midget through a window?
Sure, yeah.
Like, that actually happened. I sat there in disbelief, I think, for, like, 5 minutes, like, recently. Like, when I reread that, oh, yeah, like, I forgot. He took a midget and threw a plate glass window in some bar in Philly or something.
I think it's Phoenix. I think in Phoenix you can get away with that
shit. Oh, okay. That's a misdemeanor there.
Yeah, well, remember also Charles
Barkley. Go to Dan Marley's bar and throw midgets through the window.
Charles Barkley was also the person who he got pulled over by a cop for speeding. And I think he got a DUI, but he was explaining to the cop, no, I'm going to get a blowjob. And the cop was like, what? He's like, no, it's a sure thing. This girl's going to blow me. And it's like, he's like, yeah, you're going to jail.
I would have loved it if like the cop was like, I'll give you an escort. just stick close to my...
Oh, yeah. it's like they used to do that for like pregnant women. Any other sport?
The Warriors have lost 2 games since I think we last podcasted, which is insane. Like, that's more than they lost like the previous like 9 months.
They'll be fine.
Yeah, I think they might be.
In the college football championship, are you enjoying bowl week?
Oh God, no! In fact, like I can't. I totally like college football's like so mismanaged and fucked up now. Like the whole playoff thing. The fact that they had it like on New Year's Eve, like the playoff, and like it was the next day before I realized that those games were even played. And I was like, oh shit! Like yeah.
Well, did you read like why they did that? Is because ESPN like paid all this money for the college contracts,
right?
College football contracts, and they want to establish, they want to own New Year's Eve in the same way that like the NBA owns Christmas Day, or the NFL owns Thanksgiving.
Right. Well, they already own New Year's though. Like, why didn't they just use that?
I know. Hey, no, listen, I'm not saying it's smart,
right?
But yeah, and so like, yeah, supposedly the ratings were like down 36% from last year.
A lot of people have to work on New Year's Eve, like it's not an automatic holiday for most people, and so like the idea of like football on New Year's Day is perfect because it's like okay, like everyone's waking up at like 10 or 11 o'clock, and like there's football already, and it's going to be on all day.
You're hungover.
Exactly, fantastic. Like just recipe for success. But like New Year's Eve, fuck that. Like you're either like working or you're preparing to go out or you're going out.
Also, like the late game on the East Coast, it's like you're scheduling a game on the one night a year that you know everybody has plans.
Right. the one night that like every sports fan promised their girlfriend they'd go hang out in Times Square.
Right. Exactly. Yeah, it's just ridiculous.
Yeah. Like just bad ideas all around. But like the. Now, the final championship game is what, like next Monday or something?
I don't know.
Like, I don't know. They play it like 3 months from now. But it's, it's what, Clemson, Alabama?
Clemson, Alabama.
Jesus,
and you know what? Alabama is a 7-point favorite, and you give those 7 points.
Is Clemson in Alabama or is that in Georgia?
It is in South Carolina.
Oh, shit. Oh, you're right. Okay.
Mr. Geography.
I couldn't get my shit kicker university straight.
one of my trivia questions was, what are the team mascots for these three universities? Clemson, Missouri, and Alabama. Oh, no, Clemson, Missouri, and Auburn.
That would be Tigers, Tigers, and Tigers.
Right? Yes, you're right.
And what about the University of Kentucky, University of Arizona, and the trying to think of another one.
I mean, they're Wildcats.
Yeah, they are Wildcats.
How about Mississippi State, Georgia, and Fresno Wait. State?
Is Mississippi State the Bulldogs? I guess, yeah, you're right. Yeah,
yeah, okay. They're all the Bulldogs.
They're all Bulldogs.
And our, I think, Butler Bulldogs, yep.
Sure, why not?
Why not? Yeah, there you go.
Why not?
Give it up for Gordon Hayward.
Everybody likes Bulldogs.
So if we were betting,
yeah,
which I don't do anymore.
Yeah, you know what, like, you know what has actually ruined sports betting? Like, not that I'm like a huge sports bettor, but like, yeah, if I ever like find myself in Nevada or something like that, I want to be able to like bet sports and like know what I'm doing. And like this whole like extra like overtime rules in like pro football now, like they've fucked up all the spreads. Like, yeah, it's like you have no idea. Like,
well, like, how so?
Because like a game like,
you mean
now,
the overs?
Well, like the well, the spreads too. Because like, you know, like if a game goes into overtime now, like there's all these like weird rules where it's like, okay, like they can score, like, you know, they can score 6 points here, or they can like, you know, win the game, but then the other team has time, you know, a chance to come back, and like, you know, and like, so you wind up like with all these games that have like these weird scores that like didn't happen before, where it's like, yeah, you know, it's like, you know, 18-13, or like, yeah, or, you know, 18-8, or, you,
oh,
know,
the extra points.
Yeah, the extra. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
that's
that, yeah, that.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, and so that whole thing is like, I feel like it's made like gambling much, much harder on football, because you like, yeah, there's like all these like extra ways to score that no one is calculating. Like, but
yeah.
I don't know.
I can't like I've had like two bad years of gambling on sports, so
right.
Like I'm starting to think that maybe this isn't the thing for me. but if I was gambling, I would say I think Alabama's going to murder Clemson.
Oh, I would think so, but
yeah.
I mean,
so I think that, I mean,
but I,
like,
also think it's like one of those things that might be fixed. so yeah, like,
yeah, yeah.
So like it wouldn't put not that Nick Saban doesn't look like the most like reputable guy in the world, but like I feel like if he could shave points and throw points, he probably would. He doesn't care.
They supposedly the word in the gambling community.
It's like, well, according to my friends, the Sharps.
Jimmy the Greek.
Yeah, exactly.
So according to those people,
right.
The only bets that are being made are on Alabama right now, because people think the line is going to move from 7 to 7.5. And if you want to take Clemson, you want to take the points, you want to get that extra half a point.
Right.
So that's the word. That's the scumbag report.
Go out and bet all your money on Clemson.
All right, Andrew. On May 6, 1954, who was the first runner to break the 4-minute mile?
That would be Roger the Band Bannister.
Sliding down the Roger Bannister.
I think one of the only reasons I know that, there's several like bits of trivia that I only know from like either like British sitcoms or Monty Python or something like that, but like I think there was a Young Ones episode where somebody said, man, it's only 4 minutes, and like somebody turned to him and said, yeah, tell that to Roger Bannister. And, like, and it was one of those jokes where it's like, I couldn't possibly laugh at it as a kid because I didn't know who the fuck that was. But then, like, later on,
I'm like,
that's funny. I don't know what it means.
Yeah, and, Bannister.
But it's like later in life, I'm like, Roger Bannister. I get it. It's like, I want to write a letter to British Television and tell them I get it.
Yeah, I finally got it. Thank you very much for years and years of confusion. All right, you want to take a break?
Sure, let's do that.
All right, that's the end of the sports report. We'll be back from Harry's. Back-to-back Academy Awards! All right, we are back.
We are back at Harry's.
I'm kind of digging their choice of music here.
Yeah, it's very, you know what, like, this is Freak Out by Chic, right?
They also played Super Freak by...
Chic?
No, by...
Niles Rogers?
No. Oh, you know...
Oh, Super Freak by... God damn it.
Everybody right now is like...
Cocaine's a hell of a drug. Motherfucker. This is the worst. This is the worst moment of my life.
I hate it when I do like the trivia nights. Like that's
Rick James.
Yeah, that's like the thing that like I love the most. But I hate it when it happens to me when you just have this brain fart.
And yeah,
you're
yeah.
Just like, oh my god, I can't. Like I know this. I just my.
And it's terrible that like it's terrible that I feel this way. But like, but if it's if it's like an African American entertainer or something like that, I almost feel worse because then I feel like, oh, I'm being racist. I can't even remember Rick James's name. that's not racism, really. But
it's Andrew Lauder with the White Guilt Report.
I confuse forgetfulness with racism.
And they're so interchangeable. You know, the sun's kind of going down here. One of the things I'm like noticing, like looking at the people walking by and like looking at this neighborhood. Not a whole lot of tattoo parlors around here.
No. Certainly not.
It's that kind of, like, neighborhood.
Yeah.
Oh, so, during the break, I was talking to the lovely Michelle, the our waitress.
Yes.
And she was telling me, I asked her about the bar. And she said, well, stop talking to me.
Do you want to order or not?
No. I mean, she told me, like, it's this called Harry's because it used to be owned by Harry Denton.
Oh, okay.
And,
of Harry Denton's Starlight Room?
Yes, exactly. Is he still alive?
I can't imagine.
I've never been to Harry. So basically, Harry Denton was a local personality.
Right.
And he owned like the Harry Denton's Starlight Room, which is at the top of like this Union Square Hotel.
Yeah, yeah.
I've never been there before. But he was just, you know, like this character in San Francisco. And she was telling me that a few years ago it was bought by these two guys. I forgot their names.
Right.
But like they own other they also own other bars. Like they own like Bobby's they own the Owl Tree when Bobby died or whatever, like they bought it from him.
Okay.
And so they're basically people who like buy bars and I don't know, polish them up.
Right,
and
right.
Remember when you were saying the painting on the wall is kind of mural? Is you're like, wow, it's got some weird shit going on there, right?
Right, right.
That's great. Thank you. Okay, it's fantastic. But I guess apparently it's a bunch of all the weird shit that you're talking about is all like Ernest Hemingway references.
Oh, okay.
And as you can see in the middle
there's like
Hemingway
with
the elephant.
Right, right.
And over here, like, is a bunch of, like, fishing stuff. And I guess he was really into fishing.
Great. Good for him.
I don't see the shotgun he used to blow his head off with, though.
I don't see the, 15 years of, like, boy toys and, like, suicide attempts, but...
We're all the cats.
Right.
When I was in Key West... I went by the Hemingway estate or whatever.
Okay.
And have you ever heard of this? It's like there's just a bunch of cats that live there.
Really?
Yeah, and it's like this, I don't know, cat heaven. I guess
wow.
Hemingway was a cat person. And they just like roam around and like you can go and take tours and feed the cats and shit like that.
What do you think that like they must have like neighbors that like maybe aren't on board with having like 1,000 feral cats running around.
Oh, right? I stepped in cat shit, but it's Hemingway cat shit.
Excuse me.
Oh, that's literary genius on my shoe.
That's right. Like, what are your overall thoughts on Hemingway? If I can get really pretentious for a second.
Well, I only read like what The Old Man and the Sea.
I haven't read hardly any of it. I'm not asking for an educated opinion.
All I know is I had a friend who went to college and he studied literature. And he said after studying literature, getting his degree for 4 years,
right.
The only thing he really came away with is that he wished that Hemingway didn't kill himself because he wanted to kill Hemingway.
Yeah, that's a good point. But so, I think that like he definitely like sort of represents a type of blowhard that like can't exist anymore. Like and same with like Teddy Roosevelt and that kind of thing where it's just like
a man's man.
Exactly. I like to go out and you know nature and fucking blow everything in the fucking face. Like you like shoot everything I can.
It's like a weird like thing where like Teddy Roosevelt, he's a guy who like started he established like the national park system or something like that.
Yeah.
He like loved nature so much, but he loved nature so much he'd like to shoot it.
Exactly. It's like what else do you do in nature besides murder everything in it?
It's like, oh, what a beautiful animal. Hand me that fucking shotgun.
Fantastic.
And I'm going to cut the fucking head off and put it in my living room. It's so weird.
Oh, I know. So anyway, like, have you seen very many movies or television shows over the last few weeks? Because I've seen a goddamn ton.
I saw The Kingsman and...
The Kingsman Secret Service or whatever the fuck that was called.
And I sat down and watched it because I saw it on some, like, best of the year lists. Mm. It's fucking horrible.
You know what? Like, I want to go back. The first 5 minutes just because it was like a music video of like shit blowing up. But
oh,
then
no.
Most of it after that, I sort of tuned out. Or at the very least, like the best sort of reaction you can get from me is that, like, you know, in the spirit of the Dave Attell joke about the opera.
Oh yeah,
where you just sit there going, "Wow, look how much work it takes to bore me."
Well. I'm so over this sort of like training teenagers to save the world, like fucking narrative. And it was just like, yeah, it's, I guess you can go back all the way to like Harry Potter, but like the Hunger Games, Ender Game, Divergent. It's like like the fucking Maze Runner. It's all like these teenagers.
Right.
And they go, or like X-Men.
Which are probably like
X-Men
the only
Origins.
People buying tickets anymore. So, like, yeah, probably, yeah.
Sure.
But at the same time, like, yeah. I mean,
we're talking about Hollywood, and Hollywood is formula driven. So,
right.
If something works, they're going to go with it. They don't give a fuck if I'm tired of it or not.
exactly.
Oh, this San Francisco podcast is sick of our shit.
Right. Well, I do like the fact that the Star Wars movie is, like, well on its way to being, like, the most successful thing ever. And, like, that's got to be good news because, like, it actually came out pretty decent, I thought. Like, like I liked it.
Although, you know, clearly the girl in the movie is going to become, like, the big star, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And, like, that's just out of the Hunger Games as well.
True,
it's like,
true, yeah.
You know, like, oh, she's, like, you know, she's, like, a nobody who, like,
right.
rises to, I don't know, fly a spaceship with a Wookiee.
Right. I do like that there is sort of like a mystery of like who the fuck she is, kind of still, like, which is, yeah, like that was, yeah, that it was good that they didn't blow their wad entirely and like, you know, tell us like, oh, you know, like you know, whatever possible spoilers that there could be, like, you're like, oh, it's, you know, obviously Luke Skywalker's daughter or whatever, you know, yeah, but you know, and I don't know that that's true or not, like,
I don't think that's true, but
it probably isn't, but like, you know,
I like the fact that she she grew up in a galactic junkyard. She's kind of like this space Fred Sanford.
Exactly. Like, that would have been a fucking, like, an amazingly sophisticated reference for them to make where, like, something scares her and she's just like, ooh, it's the big one.
Ooh, it's Death Star, the big one.
Or if you just had, like, the alien, like, doling out the fucking gruel or whatever he was for payment. Like, you just have an obvious, like, Red Fox impersonation where he's just like, okay, I'm open for business.
Andrew, what else did you see?
Let's see. Well, okay, like, one last thing I'll say about Star Wars. I did like it a lot. I think the one thing I didn't like about it was that the plot hinged on, like, basically a depressed robot not releasing, like, information that he had all along. So, like, you know, and I hope I'm, you know, spoiler alerts, I guess.
Are you talking shit about BB-8?
No, about R2-D2, actually.
Oh,
well, actually,
right.
Because, like, I mean, he had, like, the, you know, and excuse me, again, like, skip ahead 20 minutes if you haven't seen it. 20 minutes, I'm not going to talk for 20 minutes. Skip ahead for 20 seconds. But, like, just the idea that, like, so they've got these two robots, like, pretty early on in the movie together, but just because, like, they're both bummed out about shit, they don't release their information until later. It's like,
well, maybe
it's like, we could have saved, like, an hour of this movie if, like, you robots would just stop being little bitches.
Well, you know, if apparently in the future, robots still haven't figured out love, but they have depression down.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, who's programming all of these like manic depressive robots? Like,
yeah.
It's like that's the Rogue's Star Wars movie that I want to see is like the fucking miserable like, you know, the guy that's like programming C-3PO and like stuff to hobble around like being a worrywart.
Well, here's the thing. One of the things I did, the best thing that J.J. Abrams did making this movie,
yeah,
is he took C-3PO and just like got rid of him, basically. He's the worst character. Go back and watch all the Star Wars movies. He's the fucking worst character.
Yeah, like, well, he's like sort of what Tim Gunn is to like Project Runway. He just like wanders around like.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Like, well, anyway, some people will love that reference, but most people won't. let's see other movies that I saw. I'll go through these like quickly if I can. Hateful Eight, I thought was really great. I won't try to make them all rhyme, however. I won't say. Anomalisa by Charlie Kaufman has like puppets sort of playing.
Oh, really?
All the characters.
Yeah, I heard about that.
Yeah, and that was good. I liked it. It was it's not exactly what I want from a Charlie Kaufman movie, but it was still all right. Like, it's depressing in the same way that She was, I guess, in some ways.
I'm the only person I know who didn't like She.
I didn't like it either. Like, yeah, I just it left me cold, sort of in a.
I just couldn't, like, people are like talking about how, like, I get it. It's an allegory for an actual relationship.
Yeah.
But it's like, am I being like the narrow-minded person that the whole time I'm thinking you're in love with your fucking phone?
Right.
Like, I can accept the love between two gay cowboys.
Right.
I can accept the love between a person and their pet.
Yeah.
But am I crazy that, like, I can't accept the love between someone in a fucking program?
Right. And, like, and this definitely, like, sort of, like, you know, traffics in that sort of, like, you know, idea of you know, like, you know, that where, you know, relationships are, you know, are very alienating and, like, and then the whole use of, like, sort of animatronic puppets and stuff instead of people, like, yeah, it reminded me actually a lot of like a Mike Lee movie almost, but not quite as well done, and it kept some of those same beats though, which so it's worth checking out.
Speaking of Mike Lee, one of my favorite films of all time is Naked.
Yeah, that was particularly the movie I think that some of the beats of this movie reminded me of, because like there was such despair and like, you know,
oh,
sort
yeah.
of like,
yeah, watch
like,
it with someone you love.
Exactly, like great date movies of all time. Mike Lee's Naked.
What else did you see? Anything else?
Let's see. I saw the Steve Jobs movie that Fassbender and Danny Boyle. You know,
Danny Boyle, right? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
That answers my question, because I care not about a fucking Steve Jobs movie.
Unfortunately, I mean, I sort of wanted to like it. I mean, Aaron Sorkin wrote the screenplay as well. And so
he also wrote Newsroom, which is a fucking disaster.
And you know what? Like, Jeff Daniels is in this as well. And he's essentially playing the same character that he plays in, like, The Martian and, like, you know, The Newsroom. And so it's just like, yeah, I think I wrote a tweet about it or something like that, saying, like, I can go without seeing Jeff Daniels in anything for, like, 6 months now. Because, like he's so over-the-top sort of blowhard. And Fassbender, you know what? Like, he does a good acting performance, but he doesn't do a good performance being Steve Jobs, I think, in any way. And I'm not even like a big Steve Jobs guy. Fassbender's like this ridiculously handsome guy, and Steve Jobs is kind of a asshole nerd.
Yeah.
And like, yeah, and so, you know, like, the, yeah, it's I don't know, noble of him to try, but like, he doesn't. I don't think he. It doesn't ring true at all. Like, you're just like, hey, here's Michael Fassbender. Like, why would anybody dislike him?
It's so funny. Like, I wonder if, like, when you own a if someone's going to make a biopic about your life, if you get to put any, like, input into who plays you.
Right.
Because if someone's like, oh, yeah, we're going to make the Jeff Cleary story. Like, you got Brad Pitt. I'm like, yeah, of course.
Yeah,
right.
Fuck yeah.
But if it's fucking Jonah Hill, I'm like, what the fuck is going on here?
It's like, you mean, like, skinny down, like, that for Moneyball, yeah. Jonah Hill, right?
We really think that when Seth Rogen's going to do great as Andrew Lauder.
God damn it,
fuck
why?
That guy.
Why'd you do that to me? And I think like one of the only other things I saw was Creed, which I liked a lot. Rocky sequel.
I just sort of I like Michael B. Jordan.
Yeah, and he's pretty badass in it. He's really good.
I just kind of refuse to believe that like a Rocky movie can be good again.
You know what? Like, I mean, but it's the same guy that did Fruitvale Station too, mm-hmm. and so you know, it was good in sort of like a grim way. Like, you know, it wasn't quite as you know, rah rah Rocky as you would expect.
Does Creed get killed by a BART cop?
not entirely. That would have been great, though.
Strange enough, he does.
In a twist of unimaginable fate, he did.
I saw, aside from The Kingsman, I saw What We Do in the Shadows,
okay.
Which is the New Zealand vampire mockumentary by Jermaine Clement from Flight of the Conchords.
Oh, yeah.
It's pretty good. So like, feels a little dated. I kind of feel like it was made like in 2014, when I think like when, you know, True Blood was probably still hitting it, and Twilight was really big. And now like a year and a half later,
right. It's like vampires. Who cares about them?
I was like, nobody gives a shit about. Oh, it seems kind of dated. It's like nobody gives a shit about vampires. Now
we've all moved on to mummies or whatever.
No, we've all moved on to like teenagers saving the world. It's like, so. I saw that. I saw this really good, really good, really depressing documentary called Heroin Cape Cod, which...
what's that about?
It's about Cape Cod and heroin.
I never would have guessed.
But, like, yeah, apparently heroin is, like, hitting the Northeast, like, with a vengeance.
Yeah.
And it's all because of prescription pills, like painkillers. Mm. Like, people start... Everybody has the same story.
Yeah.
So they get into a car accident, they get, like, a football injury... They get prescribed Vicodin or Percocets, and then the script runs out.
Right.
And then they go, oh, well, I need to get some, like, more, like, pain pills. So, like, they go back and they try to, like, pretend that they're hurt, like, they have back problems or something like that. And then when that gets exhausted, they start buying Oxy on the street. And Oxy is, like, $30 or $40 a pill.
Oh, wow.
So that is not sustainable. And then, like, you realize, oh, but heroin's, like, $5. Mm. So everybody starts doing heroin. And, like, how heroin is just – it's pretty it's heartbreaking and kind of really it's a really interesting peek into, like, this world that I don't know anything about.
Right.
Like, they profile this one house with four junkies, and they're all, like, super supportive. It's almost like they're a family. They're like, oh, yeah, especially when they're trying to get drugs.
Right.
You know, they're injecting each other. But it's only 70 minutes, and it's all about interviews with people. And it doesn't take that long to make one of these movies, right? You could make this movie in, I don't know, 5 weeks.
Sure.
You know, you just interview these people, and then you edit it all together, right?
Right.
By the time they finish the movie, like, two of the people are dead from heroin overdoses, and two other people just disappear. So it's like, and it's really sad.
Yeah.
Because you see these people just like you kind of feel like when they're kind of together, they don't do any interviews while they're high.
Right.
But like when they're together, they seem like, oh yeah, they're pretty smart people. But it's just like, yeah, like once you get like a taste for it, you're like, some of these people just wake up and they're like, okay, all I got to do is I got to find enough money to get my next fix.
Right.
And then my day's done.
Yeah.
That's my schedule. So
it's kind of an efficient way to live if you think about it.
that's terrible. I'm just gonna eat my junk food.
I'm right in the middle. I'm about five episodes in on the How to Make a Murderer like Netflix show, like which I mean it's pretty compelling and it's and I've managed not to spoil it or whatever. It's interesting to watch, but at the same time, it does sort of take a toll on you after a while. I mean, if you're just watching hour after hour of like human misery, like whether it's like heroin addicts or documentaries on murder and like stuff like that, like it really can I think that there's a lot of people that get as addicted to like that kind of like programming and stuff like that, as much like as like heroin. Yeah, like yeah, where it's just like yeah, like these really grim like things, because you do yeah. sort of walk away from some of this stuff thinking like, oh shit, we're all fucked. Like, you know, it's like yeah,
I'm totally guilty of that myself. Yeah. Where I feel like I'm always like the movies that I tend to like are like the dark ones about, you know, destitution like desperation.
No one wants to watch a movie about like everything working out.
Yeah, but like, you know, like my favorite movie of last year was Sicario, and it's like you walk out of that it's a great movie, but you walk out of that movie like you're like, you know what, maybe I'd like to, you know, cuddle with a puppy.
Right.
You know, watch a sunset or some shit like that, you know.
Yeah, just take a bath and like
take one of those like Silkwood showers. how about this? You want another trivia question?
Sure, why not?
By population, what is the largest island country in the Caribbean?
In the Caribbean? Oh, wow.
The Caribbean.
Well, I don't know. Instinct would be to say Cuba. But I'm going to go with Cuba.
Cuba is correct. But I'm going to go 3, 2, 1. But what I'm going to do. Dana Gould reference. Everybody, listen to the Dana Gould hour.
Definitely, yeah. Always good.
Okay, how about this? By population, mm-hmm. what is the largest Arab country in the world? I'll give you a hint. It has more than twice as many people as the number two Arab country.
Wait, Muslim country or Arab country?
That's funny that you asked that, because somebody asked that last night. And I was like, no. I was like, oh, now I understand why they asked that.
Because of Indonesia?
Right. No, an Arab country is a country that speaks Arabic.
Oh, okay. And is in the Middle East, I presume.
So it's not Indonesia.
Is it Iran?
Nope.
No?
It is coming in with a whopping 88 million people.
Saudi Arabia is a little country
called Egypt.
Oh shit.
Coming in number two is Algeria.
Oh wow.
And then it goes the Sudan. Do you say the Sudan or Sudan?
Oh, I don't know.
Is it like the Hague?
Let's go and ask them. No, I think it's Sudan. I think.
I don't know. And then it goes Iraq, Morocco, and Saudi Arabia.
Wow.
Yeah. I'm surprised that Iran's not up there.
I think my answer was even in the top six.
No.
Like, that's crazy.
Your answer was bullshit.
Mine was bullshit. 100%.
Here's one right in here. This is on the last round. These are supposed to be the hard questions.
Oh, okay.
But this one is going to be easy for you. In the show The Simpsons, what is the name of the secret society that Homer joins and becomes the leader of?
That would be the Stonecutters.
They are responsible for Steve Gutenberg's career. And I'll give you one more. This is for your geography degree.
Okay.
What is the world's largest landlocked country?
Landlocked country.
Landlocked.
Well, it's not Laos.
You always say Laos.
I do always say Laos. Well, are we talking largest by population?
No, by area.
Or by area?
Sorry, yeah.
Oh, okay. Good question then. I don't know, Kazakhstan?
It is Kazakhstan.
Oh, wow.
My wife.
My
country.
I like a sex.
A lot of people put Mongolia. But Kazakhstan.
Does it have a shore, though? Or does it?
No.
No, it doesn't? Okay.
No shore for you, Mongolia.
What about Upper Mongolia?
What about goddamn Mongols?
The Mongolia over there.
Mongoloids.
All right.
You want to take a break?
Let's take a break.
All right, let's take a break, and we'll come back and we'll wrap it up from Harry's on Fillmore in Pacific Heights. All right, and we are back at Harry's.
Harry's Bar
on Fillmore in Pacific Heights. I know we're going a little long here, but I think it's just because like you and I haven't done a podcast in like a month together.
I could have talked for half an hour about how much I disliked The Martian, for example, but I didn't.
So you're welcome.
Exactly, you're welcome, America.
You want to do a little bad Yelp reviews?
We can do that, sure.
Yeah, I was kind of looking. And once again, it was a little difficult to find some bad Yelp reviews at this bar. It seems like a lot of people like it here.
I'll go first. Mine was, like, very short and sweet.
Okay, say, fuck this place. Thank you.
Close enough.
Fuck this place. 3 stars.
Stephen S. from, undisclosed, but I assume he's from here, writes, 1 star, very rude service, spelled R-O-O-D, by the doorman. He insulted my British who was visiting. We won't be back.
My British?
My British. Apparently, like, he thinks of British people as, like, property.
Yo, what up, my British?
yo, my British. Come on to Harry's. I bet they treat you right. They didn't.
I have one from Marcus K.
Marcus.
And he writes, understaffed during brunch hours. By the way, if there was a title for this review, and like, you're going by the first sentence, understaffed right. during brunch hours, you'd be like, oh, white people problems.
Exactly. Like... poached eggs weren't to my temperature liking.
seemed like there were only 3 people acting as servers/bartenders/bussers. After waiting an hour for food, it all made sense on why there was a sign to seat ourselves, oversells.
What?
Well, it's ourselves. The employees here worked their butt off, hungry. I can't help but feel conflicted between seeing them run around knowing that they are trying to get everything done, wrong orders brought to the table, dirty silverware, misinformed about extra charges for subbing fries for breakfast potatoes. Oh, God, does this guy know that people fly planes into buildings now?
Yeah, exactly.
Upper management needs to do something about these issues. On the other hand,
how many people does he think works here? I'd like to see middle management inform upper management.
I would like to see lower management.
Well, he admitted that he was conflicted too. He's like, I obviously see that they're working hard, but you know what? I'm still going to be an asshole on Yelp.
And he says, on the other hand, comma. So you're like, oh, maybe he's going to say something nice.
Right.
I know I'll never return.
I guess so. It's a happy ending then.
Yeah, you know what? It's a happy ending for the people who work here that Marcus K will never show up again.
Yeah, exactly.
Marcus, I hope somewhere you find a place that is staffed well enough to your white sensibilities.
Exactly. Well, he'll never be back anyway, so it doesn't really matter. I guess this place could turn into a, like a porn shop for all he cares.
If anybody out there knows Marcus, just tell him, hey, have you been to Harry's recently? It's so great. And you're like, well, I wouldn't know. I'm never coming back there.
Fantastic.
Hello. Oh.
That girl is 20, is maybe 10 years old. No,
so what is your final analysis, Phil Jumanu, of Harry's?
Of Harry's. You know what? Like, I would give it C+. Like, I mean, it's a fine bar. It's, I guess the Hemingway painting is nice, but, like, there's nothing particularly like standout great about it. Like it's very ordinary. I don't feel like I'm in San Francisco necessarily. Other than looking out the window and seeing like horrible rich people.
Well, I feel like I am in San Francisco because there's horrible rich people everywhere.
But that's only the window seat though. I think like the bar itself like doesn't really set itself apart in any way.
I actually like the bar. It grew on me. Like I said, as soon as I like walk in, I see like a clean sports bar. I'm like, what the fuck's going on here?
What are they hiding?
What's this all about?
You have the killer whales out back?
Yeah. But, yeah, you know, it's not the kind of bar I would travel to. But, like, it's – if I lived in this neighborhood, I might come here. Although if this place was crowded, I would never come here.
No.
Yeah,
no,
because it would be crowded with, like, a bunch of people that I have, like – don't really want to socialize.
Yeah, I can imagine if every seat in this place was filled, including the outdoor seating. When I walked up, I'm pretty sure I would want to murder like at least 90% of the people in here.
Yeah,
but as it is now, like it's just people's parents for the most part, and like a couple of extra stragglers and us. So it's not so bad.
People just waiting for their residual checks to come in.
Exactly, people. Waiting for their source of cash to get home or whatever.
Do you have any plugs, Andrew?
Well, apart from our wonderful live show, January 23rd, 4 p.m. at Piano Fight.
Never heard of it.
Taylor in San Francisco. Let's see. Do I have anything else? I guess just there's a few shows actually that I'll throw out there during Sketchfest. Aside from our own, I mean, like, you know, if you have to go see more than one show, I will say that Alex Cole and Chris Thayer are at the Punchline on the 14th.
Ooh, that sounds good.
Janine Brito and Dave Thomason are at Docs on the 15th.
Ooh.
And to round out the sextet of, like, great ex-San Francisco comedians, Josh Androsky and Claire O'Kane are at Brava on the 16th.
Nice.
So, and then there's a little show called Barcast at Piano Fight on the 23rd.
Janine Brito and Dave Thomason once did this Christmas show at the Dark Room, mm-hmm. and they just slapped together this sketch that they did where they were... Like, Janine was like a little girl waiting for Santa to show up,
okay.
and Santa doesn't show up, but L. Ron Hubbard shows up, and it was like so fucking funny.
That's great.
And like he even wrote a Scientology Christmas jingle,
right?
And I said to him afterwards, how long have you guys been working on it? And like Dave goes, honestly, we wrote it on the bus on the way over here. And I was like, I hate the two of you so much because you're so fucking talented. Slap something together that I've actually reached out to them to do again during the holidays. God. And they're like, well, they live on different coasts now, but good for them.
Yeah, we definitely will have to try hard to get both of them as guests soon.
Oh, absolutely! Yeah.
We already recorded one with Dave Thomason, but it was lost to our
own. It's the lost episode. If you're one of these like SF Barcast archivists, that's the that's like the holy grail.
That's right. Like we pieced it together from other people's phones that were near them in the bar or something.
I don't think I have any plugs. Just go to Sketchfest. Have a good time.
Definitely, that's what we'll be doing.
Yeah, exactly.
And hopefully we'll have lots more jock sniffing opportunities and maybe we'll get a few big giant celebrities to say hey, you're listening to SF Barcast, my name is Lorraine Newman or whoever.
This is Gilbert Godfrey.
This is Sally Field. You should be listening to the SF Barcast.
Do you have any New Year's resolutions, Andrew?
Not really. I think as we discussed earlier, I'll try to avoid shitty things happening and hope that not shitty things happen.
I know. I think my New Year's resolution is to suck less.
Exactly. My New Year's resolution is to crush it. And my New Year's resolution next year is to continue to crush it.
Continue crushing it. Continue crushing it. All right, this is SF Barcast. I'm Jeff Cleary.
I'm Andrew Louder.
And we'll see you next time.